You're listening to WCAT Radio, your home for authentic Catholic programming.
Welcome all Radio Maria listeners to this brand new edition of Faith and Sport. And now without further ado, here he is, the host of Faith and Sport, Dr. John Acquaviva.
Hey everybody, welcome to Faith and Sport here on Radio Maria. It's co-production of WCAT. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva, Faith and Sport, where we apply our faith to all aspects of sport. Here's what we're going to do on the show today. We're going to talk today's sports topic, including our hit or miss with Ed Billick, longtime friend, for years been a regular guest on the show, radio veteran. He's going to join us in just 1 minute. And the second half of our show is Kevin Reilly, a former NFL linebacker and author of the book Tackling Life, How Faith, Family, Friends, and Fortitude kept an NFL linebacker in the game. And the very last segment, I'm going to do something out of my book. Folks, I want to talk a little bit about my book. I'm so happy that this has now been published. It's called Improving Your Sportsmanship Through Catholic Teaching and Common Sense. And one of the small little snippets from that book we'll talk about, and it's part two of sport and winning and losing. And this time we're going to talk about sport and losing. So if you want to know exactly what I'm talking about, stay tuned for this show, and in particular, the very tail end of it. We'll talk about this segment in my book called Sport and Losing. Folks, wherever, whenever, and however you're joining us, we are so appreciative of it. You're listening to Radio Maria, co-production of WCAT Radio. Let's bring in our guest, Ed Billick. Buddy Ed, welcome back to the show. How are you doing today?
John, always a privilege, always a privilege to be here with you and talking to all of our loyal listeners there at Radio Maria. Across 13 affiliates or something like
that. It's close to that, brother. Texas, Louisiana, Wisconsin, some of the greatest. Oh, Pennsylvania's in there. Duncansville is, or it's Duncansburg or Duncansville. I think I said that one of the last times. But yeah, brother, we're heard on a lot of radio stations throughout the country, and we're just happy to be here.
So it's the middle of Lent. How's your Lent going for you?
It is. It's so funny because, you know, I've done a lot of things, probably more than most. But one of them is we gave up TV. And Alicia mentioned the other day, she says, you know, it's actually a lot easier once after the first day or so is over. And you know what I've been reading, Ed? Vatican II. That's what I've committed to my reading instead of any TV time we have. Have you? I don't want to put you on the spot on that way, but it's just a great document. It's so beautifully written. And it really was, as every, you know, as the older of our listeners know, it was the document that came out in the 1960s in which John the 23rd said, let's open up the windows here and let in some fresh air. And of course, one of the main outcomes of that, the outcome that I always think of, is that it went from a pure and full Latin mass to saying mass in the vernacular, whatever was the local language.
Well, see, as an altar boy, we learned the first prayer was a deum qui laetificat juventutem meam. And we practice all of the prayers in Latin. Once we got really good at it, about 6 months later, they said, now we're going to English.
You're like, gosh, dog it. That is funny. You know, brother, over the years, you have quoted a lot of...
I say Dominus vobiscum, and you say...
In peace,
Ecclesia Spiritu 2.0. Yeah.
Yeah, very good.
So you start bringing up the Vatican II. And then, of course, the big thing, the priest was now facing us.
That's right. Yeah, that was the other big thing that was both. It was one in the, you know, it was one in both, right?
And by the way, probably what John has been reading is more the guts, more of the why behind all those. Those were just some of the visible signs that we as practicing Catholics saw.
And of course, what they did was, like, for instance, I'm reading about the role of marriage and family in the Christian household and just in our culture. And it's just so beautifully written. Like, if nothing else, folks, you pick up, just turn to any page in that document. And even if you don't agree with what they're saying, you would probably look at those sentences and just say, boy, whoever wrote that was like a poet. Brother, how was your Lent? You asked me about mine. Give me a comment or two about your Lent.
Well, good. Our Crucio group has been meeting every Saturday, and that's always a good moment of going through your acts of the week, the acts of faith, your prayer of faith, and that. Over at St. Matthew, we did Tuesday's Talks with the Priest, and Father Balky did one on prayer. And I tell you, it was an hour of interactive with about 60, 70 people. I helped run the audio visual for that, but more importantly, it was a great experience. And then still every Thursday, we review the readings before Sunday. So all of that. What am I trying to do? I'm trying to watch the entire series of The Chosen again. I think I mentioned that last time. And I tell you what, John, I would have loved to have been at the wedding of Cana.
Yeah,
the way they did that and the way that Jesus converted the water to wine, just done up very well. So, no, it's going well.
That's interesting you mentioned that because, you know, one of the things that we found out was that there's a documentary about Jonathan Rumi, the gentleman who plays Christ. And I'm looking forward to getting through that, and we'll probably see the rest of that after Lent when we start watching TV more often. But boy, he seems genuine. He's a convert to the faith. I think you know that. And he's just genuine. And I think he was perfectly chosen for that role. Oop, sorry about that.
And he has the facial features. And he has that loving kind of kind look of an individual.
He does. He does. Folks, before we get into our hit and miss, just a reminder, you're listening to Faith in Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Joining me, as he does just about every time on this show, for our hit and miss and other sports topics is Ed Billick. As usual, buddy, let me remind everybody, if they're listening for the first time, I should say, the hit and miss conversation is something that's good or positive that has happened in the world of sport that Ed and I have kind of linked on to and we think we should share with you. I think you have a particularly good one today, and it was a surprise to me in our pre-show discussion. I didn't even know this, but brother, you go first. What is your hit or miss?
John, you know, in life, especially for people, you and I have been come across many, many, many souls, many individuals.
Yes.
You look at how people act and behave, and you watch how they interface with others. And especially in the world of sports, many times you say, I bet you that is a person of faith. Well, I had that feeling this morning, bright and early. So I went and I said, what is the faith of Caitlin Clark? Now, Caitlin Clark, last week, she broke Pete Maravich's college basketball scoring record for a female. She is the all-star of the Iowa Hawkeyes. She is just one phenomenal athlete. You got to watch her. She's energizing female sports in college basketball. And I said to myself, what faith is she? And the answer came up, is she Jewish or Catholic? I go, hey, maybe something's going on here. The answer was Caitlin Clark's religious identity is firmly rooted in Catholicism. Despite speculation, she's not Jewish. She was born and raised in West Des Moines, Iowa. Her educational journey reflects her Catholic upbringing. She attended St. Francis of Assisi Catholic School for elementary. Yep. She went on to Dowling Catholic High School for instilling Catholic principles in its students and throughout her life. Her family's been actively involved in the Catholic Church, indicating significance of faith within her household. And it just says this is allowed to shape her religious beliefs or practices and shaped her character in guiding both her actions on and off the basketball court. So the answer's there. The answer was there. And I knew something was special about her when it came to her faith.
See, buddy, this is one of the reasons I love to do this show. And I think this is a great story, right? The Caitlin Clark alone is a great story. But you woke up today and you said, I wonder what faith she is. And, you know, the thing is we talk about this stuff weekly, right? I think about this stuff all the time. I always think about topics to talk about, topics to write about, especially on this show, topics to talk about. And it didn't even occur to me. What faith is Caitlin Clark? Now, let's give this a little more direction. And for those who aren't big basketball fans or even sports fans, God bless you for listening to the show, especially if that's the case. But Ed, is it safe to say that she is as popular as a female athlete has gotten in the last 10 years? Is that safe to say?
I could say Simone Biles. I could think of some of the Olympians. But as far as softball or basketball or some of those
team
kind
sport
of
sports, athlete,
team sport athletes. Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely. And, you know, this note just further says her principles of discipline, perseverance and compassion still throughout her schooling have undoubtedly contributed to her success as a basketball player and how she interacts with her team on the floor. Yeah. She's decided to go pro. She has 1 year eligibility left. I mean, so be it. Let more people at a higher level enjoy her skills.
Absolutely.
I think she's just a great human being. But to answer your question, absolutely, at least in the last 20 to 30 years.
Yeah, no, I think even as we talked off air, whenever an athlete is doing something, they're in the midst of a record, they're in the midst of a championship season, and they're leading their team well, whatever the case is, I think that person often elevates into the top five, top 10 of greatest athletes of all time. But that's just because they're on our mind. They're in our foresight, right? That we see them regularly on the news, on sports shows and so forth. They're on the radio, talk shows and all that. But I think this is legit. I think we're going to know who she was and remember who she was despite, or regardless, I should say, of her WNBA career that's going to come up. I'm sure she's going to be successful there. But folks, she's the real deal. And if one of the things, folks, is, Ed, you probably noticed this as well. If you watch any tape of her, one of the things is not her scoring on layups or short shots. There are always these, not just three-pointers, Ed. There's these long three-pointers. Sometimes she's 5, 6, 7 feet beyond the arc, the three-point line. And as a buddy of mine pointed out, he's a big basketball guy, he immediately said, John, it's because she has to. In other words, if she even gets near that three-point line, they guard her, but they'll let her shoot from 6, 7 feet beyond that arc, which means they're 22 feet. No, even beyond that, shots. I'm telling you, sometimes she's a couple steps beyond half court or before half court. It's unbelievable.
You know, when we were all growing up, we loved playing basketball, and it's been maybe 10 years really since I played some basketball. When you hit a shot like that, you go, I feel good. It's a luck shot. You were lucky.
Yeah, yeah.
Where she just throws it up, and it's like her, Steph Curry, and a lot of these people.
That's right.
How do they do that?
No, I know. It shows the skill and the practice that went into it. Boy, she probably has taken a million shots in her life, but boy, is she impressive to watch. Just
absolutely. So she is the Cathlete of the Year nominee.
That's right. We at the end of the year, come December, as most programs do, radio and TV, we'll do our roundup of all the best stories of the year, and even have whoever's in the kind of the bowl for Cathlete of the Year, and she's in there. She's the first person in this year.
For our listeners, you're going to have to define Cathlete. That's a made up name here.
It's a made up name for this show, in which I combine the two terms, athlete and Catholic. And so whoever is practicing their faith, they're a Cathlete. So God bless you, brother. Thank you for bringing that story forward. Mine is about Bear Wozniak. He is a radio personality, and his show is on, it's a national show. It's on EWTN. And he had me as a guest, but it's different experience when you're on with him, Ed, because really it's like our segment where it's really just us together, right? None of us takes the lead. None of us has more time than the other person does. And that's kind of the way Bear Wozniak's show is. And it's because he has so much to say, and a little bit about Bear. He's a faithful guy. He started on EW 10 years ago, and I think he's like most guys. He had a reversion. His dad is a faithful deacon in the church, and his like theme is you be fully Catholic, but still be fully a man. Do things that are manly. Lead the household. Be the physically strong guy in the household. Be the guy who fixes stuff. Just be a guy. Whatever it is that makes these traits about a man that stand out from a woman, he says, just be that. If that's what you want to be, just be that and be proud of it. In fact, this won't surprise you, Ed. This won't surprise our audience. His latest book is called 12 Rules of Manliness. And the subtitle is actually a question. Where have all the cowboys gone? And the reason that it was a hit is that he is funny, he's energetic, and he's got these great stories, but also, just like we expect and we hope for on any Catholic show, he's a faithful guy, loves his faith. And you and I had a chance to meet him personally, because when you and I were covering the Men's Conference of North Carolina, it's called the Conference of the Carolinas, you and I were asked by the president of Carolina Catholic Radio to go down there and report live from that conference. And we got a chance to meet Bear Wozniak. And I think you found him like I did. He's just energetic. He was the keynote speaker at that conference. I just thought he did a nice job. And I really appreciate the fact that he asked me to be on his show. And
I don't know about you, John. If you pull up to a biker bar and you see a guy on a motorcycle and they're pounding down bourbon and drink, you know, smoking cigars,
yeah.
I don't know about these guys. They look pretty rough, but that's who he is. That's who he is.
Yeah, he's genuine. Yeah. In fact, he had a TV show, and this is terrible. Barrel Pie. He would go, "What? You forgot the name of it?" But it was a show in which they would drive on Harleys, him and a bunch of other men from like town to town. And they would have a TV crew with them and just their little, whatever they were doing from town to town, just being men. And he just loves saying that. He goes, "We're just being guys, stopping at bars. We're having a drink. We're having a cigar. Let the alcohol wear off. And the next morning we get on our bikes and drive to a new town." And tell the truth, I don't think it was much more than that, but they're all faithful guys. And that's what I appreciate about them. And that's my hit of the week. Bear's my hit of the week. His show's the hit of the week. And
how can folks find him, John?
It's just bearwoznick.com. So let me, his name, and to tell the truth, I've known him for years. He's been on our show 3 times. I've been on his show 3 times. And I don't know his given first name, but he goes by Bear, and his last name is spelled W-O-Z-N-I-C-K. So it's just like it sounds, Bear Woznick. And if you just put in Bear and Man, especially EWTN, a bunch of stuff. You can even see him. There's a bunch of YouTube videos and shows that they posted on YouTube. So give him a listen. And if you're a guy, I think you'll greatly appreciate his message. It's just be a guy, be faithful, and don't make apologies for being a guy and doing guy things. I think he would appreciate me summing it up like that. Folks, you're listening to Faith and Sport here on Carolina Catholic Radio. Oh, sorry. This is Radio Maria. It can be heard on Carolina Catholic Radio, but also on WCAT. It's a co-production of those folks there in Connecticut. Faith and Sport, where we merge the world of sport and virtue. So, brother, one of the things I want to talk about, we have a few minutes left. I want to get into this conversation about gambling and the toll I think it's taking in the sports world. But I want to mention, this is just briefly, folks, Riley Gaines, she's another accomplished female athlete. She was an All-American swimmer, I think about 2 years ago now. And because of one of the people that beat her was this Leah Thomas, this guy who beat her, was an average male swimmer, came over to the women's side, beat her directly. And then she just jumped on that and she has become a spokesman. I think she's faithful. I don't think she's Catholic, but she has been on just about every major conservative TV and radio station. And I've been wanting to get her on this show. And I even mentioned that to you. And out of the blue, Ed, tell me why you reached out to me a week ago about her.
Well, she was, I guess she was in town or she was locally going to speak here. And she reached out. She reached out via Facebook on Messenger. By the time we got back.
Her agent.
Excuse me?
Her agent.
Her agent did, not her. I'm sorry. And by the time we got back and organized it, it was too late.
Yeah.
But, she was wanting to share because she heard about this show, Faith and Sport. How she heard about it, I don't know, folks. You must be spreading the word that she knows about us. So we're still going to try to get her on.
No, I appreciate that. In fact, that's what we mentioned to her agent. Hey, we still want to have her on, but they're really interested in being on this show to help promote her speaking engagement here in North Carolina.
Absolutely.
Now, Ed, speaking of North Carolina, on March 11th, I think the date is, it's a big day in the history of North Carolina. At least that's what people are saying, because gambling will become legal on March 11th of this year, which is just a few days away. Everybody's making a big deal about it, right? Radio stations are promoting it. And I think a lot of these apps are sending messages out because that's, you can gamble through them and so forth. But Ed, I think this is problematic for the world of sport. I think this is problematic for our culture and our society. And it's just changing the landscape of sport. In fact, Ed, I think you would agree with me on this. Sport is as big as ever, but one of the reasons sport is big as ever is because people have shifted from not just being a fan of a team or being a fan of the sport, they're a fan of gambling on those sports and those teams. What say you?
I don't know how big it is. And then you'll say, well, it's millions of dollars.
Millions, yeah.
Millions Billion. Of dollars. Wall Street Journal did an article a couple of days ago that some of these graduates, college graduates, are heavily betting on sports to help pay off their student loans.
I'm laughing. That's terrible. Is that true? You read that?
I don't. You know, my point is when you hear only 3% actually win or you get your money back,
Yeah.
I mean, like you and I have said, it says, I'm not a gambler. I don't care if it's legal or not. I'm not going to partake. But there are, however, people that this becomes huge in their life. The problem is the behavior. And we could talk the catechism and all that. But the bigger problem is there's so much money on this that I don't want to see it affect the outcome of the game. And that's what I'm afraid of.
Yeah. And of course, there was a athlete, I think it was for a major league sport. It was a major league sport. And he got suspended because his claim was that he was making bets for his friends. But I'm not sure the NFL believed that. I think that was the whole point, is that they're saying this doesn't really make sense.
Roger Goodell, good 5-10 years ago, quoted, we will never tolerate gambling. And then they do a 180. They do a 180 because the magnitude of the money involved. To your point, it's, let's put the clock 5 years ahead. How would it have impacted sports?
Yeah,
because North Carolina is not one. I mean, there's many of the states now. It's legal.
That's right.
Up on your iPhone and bet if John Acquaviva is going to, you know, walk five steps to his car, is he going to run to his car?
I
mean, that kind
of stuff. I know that sounds funny, but that's, of course, exactly what people
bet on.
You can
bet on anything.
You can bet on anything. You can bet on who's going to make the first three-pointer of a basketball game. You can bet on who's going to hit the first home run of a game. Who's going to win the coin toss in any.
You can bet on the Tigers and the Pirates making a World Series. I wouldn't do that, but you can.
Definitely don't do that. You know, Ed, I want to mention the story, and this maybe will help put it in perspective. A buddy of mine, a single guy, makes decent money, never has gotten into financial trouble as far as I know. He's a dear friend of mine, and I think he would have shared that with me if that was the case. But the Cliff's Notes to this story is the following. He was a gambler for decades, and after a while, he started to see the light. And the light in this case was, it's, you don't make money gambling. You make money taking the wager. You take the money from the people gambling. So he became a bookie. He did so well his first year. I'm not exaggerating. He's a dear friend of mine. He did so well in his first year. He said it became boring and he got out of being a bookie. And you know why, Ed? I said, you're going to stop doing this? You're making tons of money. And he goes, John, it's no fun, but also it's sad because you just take advantage of these 2- and 3-time losers, right? These people lose $500 on Saturday and then they double up on Sunday to try to win it back and then some. And of course, they lose Sunday and they're even further behind. And there was one guy that was so far behind, he asked him just to give him a percentage of what he owed and then he could call the slate clean. Isn't that unbelievable?
The sad part is, and you'll see a lot of these commercials on for FanDuel or DraftKings, and they make it sound so glorious and they play on your emotions and there's a deception going on. These people are getting paid good money to provide that deception, but you could be a weak spirit and really just get sucked in. And after that, you can't pay your rent and can't buy groceries.
Yeah, no, I know. In fact, it's something that it's like any other addiction. It's all you have to do is, in this case, make a couple clicks, ask a few people, and they're going to tell you some sad stories. The thing that surprises me the most, Ed, is how much of the conversation it is in sports now on TV and on the radio, where just 5 years ago, they would completely avoid it because it was off. What's the term I'm looking for? It was not allowed. It was kind of like looked down upon if you spoke about it. But now on CBS and NBC and ESPN and anybody who's covering a game of any sort, they'll say, here's who's favored in this game.
Well, no, the bottom thirds scrolling across the screen.
That's right.
All the odds.
That's right.
And
that's
I'm the thinking, other thing. Okay. Yeah. Okay. The odds. Okay. What's the odds? And then there's shows with the odds. It all started with fantasy football, rooting for individuals' performance. I mean, you can spend a lifetime doing this kind of work.
No, I think you and I.
It's all too consuming.
It is, and brother, I'm going to end the conversation with this. You and I talked about this in our preparation for this segment, and that was on the radio station that you work for here in North Carolina. They have been advertising that betting, gambling will be allowed, and of course, it's sponsored by a gambling site. But Ed, I want to say those, how long are those commercials? 30, 45 seconds long?
If that.
Okay. So let's say it's a 30 second long. 5 seconds of it is devoted to if you are a problem gambler.
Yeah, we've all heard them. But I'll tell you, I can't. You start thinking about in business and capitalism, you can't fault them. I bet you they're paying premium dollars for those spots.
Oh, of course.
And the radio station's job is to make revenue. Okay. So I'm not going to turn that down.
No, of course. It's something that you heard here first, folks. It's going to be highly problematic. I think it's problematic now. I think you're right, Ed. Take a look 5 years from now, because it's basically been in the last 2 years that it's become kind of like full tilt. And I think with more states,
we'd love to hear the listeners' thoughts. And if they have a thought on this, John, how can they get a hold of you?
I love that, brother. Thank you. You can email me at faithandsport@wingate.edu. Just like it all sounds, faith and sport. That's A-N-D and then at wingate.edu. Or you can tweet me, which is now X, right, Ed? It's now X instead of Twitter. It's j.aquaviva1, the number one. Folks, I want to know how you feel about this. Do you know people who bet? Do you bet more now than you did 5 years ago? Did you start betting recently? You've never had before. What are your overall thoughts on that? Ed and I would like to know. We'd like to read those responses on the air too. Ed, as always, this was a quick 20 plus minutes as it always is. But brother, I appreciate you so much. I appreciate your mind in sport. I appreciate your faith. Thank you for everything you do for our faith, brother, through Crescillo and in your parish. And brother, let's go ahead and talk again soon. Okay.
Great, John. Hey, y'all be safe and God bless.
See you, buddy. All right, folks, you're listening to Faith in Sport. That was Ed Billick. Regular voice here on the show. If he doesn't join me for the show, it's just not the same thing. I love that man, and I love what he has to say about the world of sport. And he's a faithful guy as well. Boy, was that a great hit or what? The one on Caitlin Clark. I wonder what faith she is. And he looks her up, and she's not just Catholic, but she's a faithful one. Folks, Faith in Sport, we look at sport through a Catholic lens. So whether you are a athlete, a fan of sport, a parent of an athlete, grandparent of an athlete, referee or administrator, this show is for you. Folks, speaking of all those people, fans, athletes, parents of athletes and so forth, I have a new book and I'd love that you would give it a read. You can get it on Amazon either as an ebook or as a paperback. It's a quick read either way. It's called Improving Your Sportsmanship Through Catholic Teaching and Common Sense. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in the end of the show when I do a segment on sport and losing. Listen, stay right where you are. Kevin Reilly, former NFL linebacker, author of the book Tackling Life. He'll be on with us in the second half of our show, which is going to start in just a couple minutes. Stay right where you are. You're listening to Radio Maria, a co-production of WCAT Radio. We'll be right back.
Maria USA. Our mission is to announce the good news of Jesus Christ to the world, to bring hope through the knowledge of His mercy, forgiveness, and love. You can help us through your prayers and monthly donation by going to radiomaria.us. That's radiomaria.us. And click on the Donations tab where you can donate securely online or see the address to donate by mail or by phone at the number listed. Thank you for your generosity. Through the intercession of our Blessed Virgin Mary, may God continue to bless you.
Hello, dear listeners. This is Father Joseph Iannuzzi, host of Learning to Live in God's Divine Will. You can listen to my program every Saturday at 11 a.m. Central, 12 p.m. Eastern here on Radio Maria. Join me as we explore the scriptures and how to best apply them to our lives. That's Learning to Live in God's Divine Will, every Saturday, 11 a.m. Central, 12 p.m. Eastern, here on Radio Maria, a Christian voice in your home. Peace be with you.
Hi, I'm Kevin Fano, production manager for Radio Maria USA. Radio Maria USA would like to thank all those who have answered Our Lady's call through their talents, donations, and prayers. You're listening to Radio Maria, a Christian voice in your home.
Welcome back back to Faith in Sport. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. I teach exercise science right over there, Wingate University. But every once in a while, I get on these airwaves of Radio Maria, and we do a show called Faith in Sport. Thank you for joining us today, wherever, however, and whenever you're joining us. There's a lot of different ways to jump into a podcast, a radio show. Either way, we're thankful that you're here. Joining us in 1 minute is Kevin Reilly. He's a former NFL linebacker for the Philadelphia Eagles, in fact, author of Tackling Life, How Faith, Family, Friends, and Fortitude Kept an NFL Linebacker in the Game. 1 minute, he's going to join us. Folks, if in the first segment we talked about gambling in sports, I want to know what you think about that. Ed brought up a great point. He says, let's see what the listeners think about this. So to let me know how you feel about gambling in sports and how it's evolved and so forth, how big it is. Email me at faithandsport@wingate.edu, or you can tweet me at j.aquaviva1. Faith in Sport, where we apply our faith to all aspects of sport. So here's a guy who has been applying his faith to all aspects of sport. He's been talking to a lot of people. One of the reasons I like talking to Kevin Reilly is he brings so much energy to the show, and I know he brings energy to the audiences in which he talks. In fact, I want to talk to him about that right after we get going. But let's first welcome back to the show, Kevin Reilly. Welcome back to Faith in Sport, brother. How you doing?
John, it's been too long since I talked to you. Got to get some stuff. Got to tell you some new stuff. It's great being here, John.
I know it's going to happen, Kevin. The first time I talked to you, I go, well, I got to have him on at least one more time. And then I had you on the second time. I go, well, I got to have him on at least one more time. So, Kevin, just expect an email in the next couple of weeks. I'm going to say, Kevin, come on the show again, brother. I love your energy. Kevin, there's a bunch of stuff I want to talk to you about. So let's try to get to it. But the first thing I want to talk to you about is tell us about what you did this weekend. You're in my home state of Michigan. Tell exactly what you just told me before we went on the air.
Well, outside of getting there, which is like three, was half the problem. I had to fly in to Detroit, had a 2-hour wait, flew down to Traverse City.
Yep.
Lovely place. What a place.
Love it.
Almost a throwback. Just really good people. But here's the deal. I had to do 4 speeches out there for them. And, wow. One on Friday, because I was going to go out a day early, and they said, is there any way you can talk to the Catholic high school, St. Francis High? I said, yeah, I can do that. You know, I can awesome. Do that.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I sit back and I go, how am I going to connect?
Yeah.
I'm 72 years old. I still know I got some energy left, but how am I going to connect with freshmen in high school about their Catholic faith?
Yeah.
And, you know, you get a little anxious. I start doing some writing. I start looking at some videos from some other people, you know, that may have done that. So it clicks with me, this, that, and the other. I get up there in front of this crew. There's 400 of them, freshmen. Co-ed, that was a first for me. Co-ed, I'm usually talking to boys' schools or whatever, you know, all male. And, you know, I've got quite a few little things that I use from a football aspect, you know, to compare our faith with, you know?
Yeah.
And I wonder if the girls are going to get this, you know? But I can't dumb it down just for that for the guys. I went on for 40 minutes. I had a Q&A with him that was remarkable.
Awesome.
Remarkable. And we get done, and the kids are, I get off stage. I've got to go get a glass of water. I've just been up there for 50 minutes, and I got a glass of water. The guys sought me out to shake my hand, to say, what are, you know, and I'm talking to them about leadership, about how they have to carry the mantle to the next level. And how they have to have the value system that they're being taught for. And how if they don't have it, they ought to be ashamed of themselves because of their parents working hard to put them in a Catholic school that teaches that and endorses it.
Yeah.
Girls never came up one-on-one. They had to be in threes and fives and sixes. But, you know, it was so cute to see them saying, hey, we got most of that. We didn't understand some of the football stuff, but it didn't matter.
Yeah.
Well, that made me loosen up because the next day I got to give 3 talks to the same audience. John, I've only done 2 talks to the same audience. So I had to get another piece in there. And sometime before we get done, I want to talk about that piece. And it's talking about the anxiety that we have in this life as Americans.
Yeah.
And Catholics, we have more anxiety.
Oh, yeah. Brother, one of the things that I'm relating to you, last year I was asked to speak to a middle school group of co-eds. They were on retreat. And Kevin, I had the same thought. I'm a decade and a couple of years younger than you, but I had the same thought. I go, are they going to, am I going to connect with them? Are they going to relate to anything I'm saying? They loved it. They thought it was fantastic. After my talk, the one of the teachers signaled to me and she goes, turn around. I turn around. There was 15 kids all standing there smiling, wanting to take a picture with me. So I know the look. I know the energy. Brother, let me ask you this from that talk. Can you remember one or two of the questions that they asked you?
Yeah.
Shoot them at me.
Because I asked them a question first. I don't want to lose this thought. The very next day when the men came for the men's conference,
yep,
I looked out. I usually see 4 to 5 young men out there under the age of 20.
Yeah.
I challenge them. Where are your boys?
Yeah.
Where are your sons? Where are your grandsons?
Yeah.
There were 20 boys that showed up from the
day before
I gave in the morning.
Yeah.
I was flabbergasted. I immediately made them stand and I said, you guys are getting my book for free today. I said, you come up, you get my book for free. For coming out. But I asked the question of, can I ask you guys a question? What upsets you most about being Catholic? What things do you think about that can't be true or you're not buying into, or you would, you know, whatever a negative is, I'd like to know. And of course it took a while. I said, I'm not going to leave this stage until somebody gives me a question. And I said, there must be a couple linebackers out there. You know, absolutely. We're not afraid of any. And the kid raised his hand and he goes, well, and he said, there's no priest here. So I can say this, but there was a priest there.
Yeah, of course.
I don't understand the priest sermons sometimes, especially when they're talking about Jerusalem and, you know, I don't follow that, you know, so well, and I don't get much out of that except for communion.
Yeah.
So, well, tell me about that experience. He said, well, outside of what I just told you, he said, I do feel that that's worthwhile. I do feel that I'm talking to my God. And that was just one of them. And that said, you know, this is why I tell people men's conferences, you need to talk to your sons and grandsons. You need to find out from them what they dislike about it.
That's right.
There could be misinformation and you could change that.
That's right.
And if it's the truth, you got to say, hey, you know what? I feel the same way. And you know what? Maybe you and me can change that.
Absolutely. And brother, that's what this is for, right? The catechism. That helps a lot of moms and dads. It's so beautifully written, brother. And this is great conversation because I want to encourage the parents out there, the grandparents out there to pull that baby out. Cause if they don't know what the church teaches and why they do it, that's a great resource. And that's the reason it's written. Folks, you're listening to Radio Maria. This is a co-production of WCAT Radio. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. My guest today is Kevin Reilly, former NFL linebacker and author of the book Tackling Life. Kevin, I'm going to read directly from this book because I found out that, brother, you quoted one of the greatest movies of all time in your book, and it made me a bigger fan of you and a bigger fan of this book. Okay, so I'm going to set this up. This is about halfway through the book in which you have just been cut by the Miami Dolphins at training camp, and you went up to where the Philadelphia Eagles were having training camp. And you wanted to talk to the coach about getting a tryout, right? So I want to ask you about that, but I want to read directly from the book. So you said, I jumped into this conversation, not sure where the sudden out of character motivation came from. And I was hoping I didn't make a complete fool out of myself. And I sputtered out the words, coach, my name is Kevin Reilly. I played linebacker at Villanova and I was recently released by the Dolphins. Is there any way that I could get a tryout? I could even bring my own helmet, which is a great, right? Like that is such a great comment. And then you go on to say in the next sentence, I must have sounded like Ralphie in the movie, A Christmas Story, pleading with Santa Claus for a BB gun. Now, God bless you for quoting one of the great movies, Christmas movies of all time, especially. But brother, I think that is fantastic. But something like that, Kevin, just to give people perspective, this wouldn't happen again, right? You couldn't walk up to, could you do that today? Anything like that? Walk up to a coach today and go, can I get a tryout?
First of all, I would never be able to get onto the field. And I was out of place doing that year. I won't mention his name. I had an agent that was dipping his feet into NFL football.
Yeah.
He was handling guys like Pete Rose and some of the great guys, some of the all-stars in baseball. And he was representing Don Strock, who was my roommate during the last couple of weeks.
Oh, no kidding.
So
okay.
Don says, call up this guy. He'll help you. So I did. And he made me say, he said, hey, I'll have you in a camp or on a team in a week. So I go home and I'm living with my parents and my dad, who, by the way, is 97 years old and not doing well. So I hope people can pray for him.
Please. But, yes.
He was one of these guys that only went through sophomore year in high school, joined the Navy, lied to him, said he was 17, he was 18, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
He was a man's man, and I'm having breakfast with him every morning, and I look up, you know, well, nobody's called me yet. And he says, what are you waiting for? I said, well, you know, I'm waiting for this guy to call me back, the agent. How do you know he's working for you? He didn't even call you. You have to say, you know, nothing's happened. Or so I said, that. He said, well, if I was you, let me just give you a piece of advice. If I was you, I would go up to the Eagles and tell them that you're available and see if they'll give you a tryout. I said, Dad, what do you think? This is a 1940s movie? You know, like, you know.
Let's who am I, Rudy?
Let's get one for the Gipper or something. You know, come on. John, he tortured me every day with that same conversation until day five. I said, you know what? Tomorrow I'm going up there. I'm going to make an ass out of myself, but I'm going to make you keep quiet. So then I said, if I'm going to go up, I'll give it my best shot. So how am I going to get into the stadium? Well, I took some information I had from the Dolphins, and this poor security guard. I hope he read my book because I didn't mean it, but I show up. He says, you can't come in here. You're not on the list. Anybody who's supposed to get into the stadium, they're practicing today. I said, I know that. I'm supposed to be practicing with them maybe. And I show him my Dolphin stuff. He said, but your name's not on the list. I said, listen, if you don't let me in there, I said, they're going to be really upset with you. So he got So he says, okay, go ahead. So I went, sat in the stands. I waited till it was over. My heart is beating in my chest.
I bet.
I run down on the field, and it was Mike McCormick was the head coach, and he was just talking to Boyd Dowler, the former Green Bay wide receiver who was great. He was our receivers coach. Boyd had just walked away. I said, here's my chance. I jumped the fence. I get up, and I'm telling you, I was stuttering. Hey, and I scared him. First of all, I tapped his shoulder. He didn't. Hey, coach, you know, blah, 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 and I just, yeah. I'm just, oh God, I blew that. And then I say, I'll even bring my own helmet. And he said, hey, Kevin, I think we have some equipment here.
Yeah, exactly.
After the conversation, he calls over the head scout. He calls over the linebacker coach. He says to the head scout, this guy says his name is Kevin Reilly. He's seventh round draft pick. He said, have you heard of him? He said, yeah, we had him on the board for the eighth round. We were going to pick him. He's out of
Illinois. Oh, neat.
Blah, 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 blah. He says, all right. He says, listen, why don't you come on up tomorrow for a tryout? I said, what do I have to bring? He said, just bring your shoes. Okay, just bring your shoes and we'll try you out. I go home. I make sure I go work out that night because I know they're going to bench presses, all that.
Yep.
I get done the tryout. You know, they can't read them. Guy comes out, the general manager, and he says, Coach would like to see you up in his office. I'm like, okay, so I'm going up there. He says, it's going to be a nice try or whatever. He says,
yeah,
I'd like to sign you to a contract.
Outstanding.
Here it is right here. I didn't even know how much money it was. I just signed it.
Yeah.
I'm at home with my Philadelphia Eagles. You talk about God moving in the wrong direction, moving me in the right direction. Now, the Dolphins did win back-to-back Super Bowls. And as much as I'd like to have been around for that ride, John,
yeah,
maybe it wasn't meant to be.
Yeah. Yep. Brother, I appreciate the heck out of that story. Just out of curiosity, from the day that you walked onto the field, you jumped the fence and kind of frightened them, to the day that that you started practice, was it like 48 hours later?
I started the very next morning.
Very next morning. And then you're a member of the Philadelphia Eagles. And how many years did you play with the Eagles?
I played 2.5.
That's awesome.
And then I played a half a year with New England. But I tell everybody, I get booed in Philadelphia when they read my bio and they say, and he played six games.
They boo everybody, brother.
Yeah. But the New England Patriots, they're still hurting over the game where, that Donovan McNabb threw up on his shoes or something, you know? So,
folks,
but I say to them, I had to come up with a comment, John. I say, I know the booing about the New England Patriots, but all I got to tell you is this, I played with them before they started cheating. I want you to know that.
Very good. I'll make that clear. In fact, after you even get off the show, if anybody doesn't have a paper and pencil, I'll make sure they write that down. Folks, get out your paper and pencil. I'm going to mention that at the end of the show after Kevin says goodbye to us. Folks, you're listening to Faith in Sport, where we apply our Catholic faith to all aspects of sport. Doesn't matter whether you're a fan, an athlete, a former athlete, a referee, a parent of an athlete. This is the show for you, because we talk sports, but we weave in character, virtue, ethics into that conversation. This is Radio Maria. This is a co-production of WCAT Radio. Kevin, we have a couple minutes left still. I want to go back to what you told me off the air, and that is something that you and I have in common. I just presented a couple weeks ago to a group of high school parents that wanted to know about sport and virtue, just virtually the same thing we talk about on the show. And you mentioned something that I think virtually all presenters, Catholic presenters, have in common, and that is we go because they've asked us to speak to them, but we get something out of that as well. What did you get from speaking to those high school kids, to speaking to that men's conference? Just share with us a little bit about what do you mean by that, when you get something out of it? And the whole thing was, they're going to get something out of you.
Well, you know, the whole time I'm really anxious because I put too much pressure on myself. I got to go out to this place for 2.5 days. I don't know how I'm going to speak to a high school with gals in it. That bothered. I could do it with guys in it. I felt confident. And then I'm thinking, wait, what if they don't like the content I have for my third speech? Yeah. So I had a little anxiety with all this. You know, I say the prayer that I always say before I do anything important like that. And hey, God, you know, send me down the right direction. Here's the prayer that I say. And I got to go out and do it.
Yeah.
So, you know, I didn't expect, especially the high school kids, to react like they did. High school kids are high school kids. John, you know that.
Oh,
if they're not buying it, they'll let you know, or they'll snub you, or they'll just look at you. The rousing applause I got, I knew something was right, because they wouldn't applaud that loudly. And they applauded for a while. Okay. That made me feel good, because the only way it made me feel good, I got through to some of them.
Yeah.
And what I challenged them is being themselves. As St. Francis de Sales said, be who you are and be that well.
That's right.
Don't follow the pact. Be a leader. You will never know who's watching you. You may be the only Bible that your neighbor or friend reads. Be a character. You've got, and a lot's on you. You've got these parents that have paid good money for you to be in here. You're getting all the right stuff. Carry it with you.
Yeah, that very good. Good.
At the very end of my third speech, I'm feeling very comfortable with the guys. You know, I like to inject humor.
Yeah.
And I just talked to them about this very subject. Do something every day to help someone. Think about it in advance. Write a list of people you've lost touch with that you know they would appreciate your call. Anybody that's hurting in your development, in your neighborhood, make sure you reach out to them. And I tell them how important that is. Well, I'm starting to really feel good about it. And I'm telling them about, they read in my book about my Walter Reed experience and talking, you know, to amputees.
Yeah.
So I opened it to the Q&A, and I'm biding time. They told me the bishop was late coming. He was the next speaker.
Yeah.
So I'm having a Q&A, and this guy in the back is all revved up, and he's talking to me. They give him the mic, and he says, I'm missing two fingers on my right hand. I think I can help somebody that maybe has lost an arm or whatever.
Yeah.
Where would I start, Kevin? Where would I start with this? I said, John, I'm not sure where you would start, but I'm not so sure you'd be very good at it, because I don't know if we can count on you. You know, I almost wanted to grab the words back, but I thought, you know, he could take that. He laughed as loud
as his body.
And those are the things. I mean, I just told you that joke because it made me feel good. Like, brother, you get it. I get it. You know. Yeah, we're both handicapped. We're going to get made fun of.
Yep.
Let it be. Let
it go. Right. That's right. No, God bless you. And brother, I am so glad that that phone rings, because I think you know this. You bring something to the ballpark, and that is you bring your faith, and people want to hear about faith. And it's so important in this day and age, brother, that people that played the game, that are playing the game, that have faith, because the people that are not in, that are in the stands and watching on TV, they're like, they have everything, right? They have fame, they have money, they have some power in their communities, whatever the case is, but they go, nope, there's something else out there. And that's one of the things you bring, Kevin. You bring that humor, and there's a certain genuineness that you have. And I think as long as you keep bringing those things, that phone's going to keep ringing, and those people are going to be at the edge of their seat going, what can this guy tell me? So you keep bringing it, brother. Hey, let's follow up with this. Let's end with this. And remember, as always, and I mean this with all the genuineness I can muster up, we're going to do this again. I think you're a great guest. So please answer that email the next time I say, come on the show, because we always have so much to talk about. But let's bring it up to date in the world of sport. Kevin, what bothers you about today's sports? Like, like of all the things going on in sport, what is something that something that we could say is that bothers you, that is a concern for you that's directly tied to the world of sport?
Number one.
Let's hear it.
Selfishness.
The players. Yeah.
Players. You know, back in the era when I would walk into the room and there's Don Shula standing there and I thought it was Jesus himself that walked in, you know, he was getting paid the most money of any player.
Yeah.
He had a way that he could love you, but he would tell you that you were doing this wrong and he could be very honest with you. Dick Vermeil had that same thing. People don't care about how much you know until people know about how much you care.
Yeah.
I can tell you right now, the Philadelphia Eagles went down the tubes at the end of the year. And one of the major factors is A.J. Brown called for a team meeting only. And anytime a player calls for a team meeting, they don't work out well. You know why?
Why?
A team meeting starts with, well, we got to do better on the defensive line. I'm the wide receiver. I'm doing pretty well. But you guys, and then the finger pointing starts.
Starts, yeah.
You break down any teamwork you have.
Yeah.
And that is selfishness. And if you even look, too, at guys who have played for a long time for a lot of money in a city that loved them, and they leave as a free agent to go play their last year or two somewhere else for more money, I got a problem with that.
Yeah. No, I get that, brother. There's so much more we could talk about. You know, I'm going to leave everybody with these two things. I love your quote to those kids. Do one thing today to help somebody else. I love that, and I think that's a great motto to live by. And the other thing is, folks, this book, Tackling Life, How Faith, Family, Friends, and Fortitude Kept an NFL Linebacker in the Game. It's Kevin Reilly, former Philadelphia Eagle and New England Patriot. My brother, thank you for everything you do to promote the faith. Thank you for being on the show today. And please respond yes the next time I ask you to come on the show. Okay, Kevin?
John, it's automatic. You call me, I'll be there.
I love it, brother. You have a
love
good day.
Love you, brother.
Talk soon. Ciao.
Be good.
You too. Well, there you go, folks. Kevin Reilly, check out his book. Boy, is that some energizing words or what? If you have a men's conference coming up, you have something going on in your parish, know that man would make the effort to come, and he's going to do a great job for those folks. So keep Kevin Reilly in your Rolodex. If you know somebody that's running a conference, having a parish retreat, whatever the case is, it's wonderful to hear from people who are faithful. It's, I think, even better to youth and people who are fans of sport to hear from former athletes or current athletes. It just means something more for reasons stated just a couple minutes ago. All right, folks, listen, I promised that I was going to do segment number two about winning and losing. A couple weeks ago, I mentioned a segment called Sport and Winning and Sport and Losing. And here's the 10 notes that I want you to make about when you lose a game. And this could mean if you're a fan of that team as well. So whether you are a parent of that athlete, you are a fan of that team, or you're the athlete themselves, here's 10 points about losing. Losing does not make you a loser. 2, losing does not make you less virtuous. 3, losing does not mean you lost favor with God. 4, losing does not make you a lesser person than your opponent. 5, losing does not mean you prepared poorly for the competition. Losing, number 6, does not mean you didn't play hard enough for success. Number 7, losing does not automatically mean the referee or official did a bad job. Number 8, losing does not give you permission to badmouth your opponent. Number 9, Losing allows for the expression of genuine respect and even happiness for the winning team. And losing, number 10, can be a good thing. In fact, use it to work harder, correct mistakes, allow it to improve perspective on competition, and demonstrates the lack of perfection in life. There you go, 10 points about losing. Listen, folks, I want to thank you for joining us today. This was as energetic as I can be for this show. Ed Billick, when he joins us, God bless him. Please pray for him. Kevin mentioned, pray for him too. He's an amputee. His dad's suffering a little bit in moments of his life. So I promise I'd pass that on. Check out Kevin's book, Tackling Life. Listen, as Pius XII said, remember that sports are not the ultimate meaning of life, but only as a means to an end, which is the full integration of development of the human person. Sports must take a subordinate role so we can give God and our family their proper place. That's from Pius XII. Before we go, special thank you to Ed Billick and Kevin Reilly for joining me on the show today. I'm Dr. John Acquaviva. Please join us next time here on Radio Maria for more Faith in Sport. And St. Sebastian, please pray for us.
Hello, God's beloved. I'm Annabelle Mosley, author, professor of theology, and host of Then Sings My Soul and Destination Sainthood on WCAT Radio. I invite you to listen in and find inspiration along this sacred journey we're traveling together to make our lives a masterpiece and, with God's grace, become saints. Join me, Annabelle Mosley, for Then Sings My Soul and Destination Sainthood on WCAT Radio. God bless you. Remember, you're never alone. God is always with you.
Thank you for listening to a production of WCAT Radio. Please join us in our mission of evangelization. And don't forget, love lifts up where knowledge takes flight.